Hey everybody, this is Dr. Oliver, and welcome to my video on the processes of DNA replication and the processes of transcription and translation. The replication of DNA starts with our original two strands of DNA, and these are going to be called our parent strands. DNA strands have a directionality to them, and that's going to be noted by these numbers 5 prime and 3 prime. Replication is performed starting with the parent's 3 prime end, and it's going to move towards its 5 prime end. So let's see how this works. So our parent strands are going to separate, and this occurs because each parent strand will serve as a template to produce a daughter strand of DNA. And the daughter strands will begin by creating its 5 prime at the parent's 3 prime end, like that. And for the second parent strand, the daughter strand, is going to do the same thing, going 5 prime to 3 prime, but this time it starts at your left. And that, my friends, is the short story of DNA replication. Now, let's take a look at some detail. DNA strands are really long, and typically we only want to copy a portion of it at a time. So what's going to happen is that a portion of the DNA will separate, and the rest of the DNA is going to stay bound together. Now, where the strands unwind is called the replication fork. Now that we have this portion of DNA remaining bound, how does that affect the creation of the daughter strands? Because remember, there's that whole 5 prime, 3 prime thing. Well, the top strand is going to be able to replicate in the 5 prime to 3 prime just as discussed. And this strand is going to be called the leading strand. But the same isn't true for the bottom strand. The 5 prime end of the parent strand is free, but that's not where we want to start. So the daughter strand, it has to go about replication differently. This bottom daughter strand is going to replicate a section at a time. It's a bit more involved, may require a few more steps, takes a little longer, and because of this, it's called the lagging strand. But little by little, it is being replicated, and being replicated 5 prime to 3 prime. No chemical process in the body is complete without those enzymes, and we're going to need a few to replicate our DNA. Now keep in mind that DNA is a supercoiled coil, and it needs to be unfurled to replicate it. Enter topoisomerase. This is the enzyme that smooths out the DNA that's about to be replicated, and it's going to be ahead of the next enzyme, which is called helicase. Helicase is responsible for breaking those hydrogen bonds that keep the two DNA strands together, allowing the strands to separate. Now that our strands have separated, they become a little flimsy, and we're going to need to shore them up a bit. And we do this with a binding protein. Now we're ready to make our daughter strands. So to begin, we're going to prime with an RNA primer, and then we can start dropping in nucleotides. The next player that comes to work here is known as DNA polymerase. Now, there's actually a bunch of DNA polymerases, and they're doing a variety of specific jobs here. But for this video, I'm going to keep it really simple, and I'm going to say that this group of enzymes adds the nucleotides and then knits them together to form that daughter strand. So, we drop in some nucleotides, and with the help of our DNA polymerase, it's going to knit that phosphate sugar backbone into place. And these little pieces are going to grow into our daughter strand of DNA. So we've just taken a look at how to replicate the entirety of our DNA. But what if we don't want to make an entire new set of DNA? Well, enter the processes of transcription and translation. This is how the body reads a section of the DNA, like a blueprint, and makes stuff, like proteins. Transcription is the copying of a portion of DNA, and this is going to take place inside the nucleus of the cell. So that we know where we are, this is the cell interior and this is the nucleus. And within the nucleus, we have our DNA. And we know that to copy our DNA, the strands are going to have to separate. Our two parent strands have separated and are ready for replication. Now, when we reproduced our DNA, we copied both sides of the DNA, right? But now we're doing transcription and we're only going to copy just one strand. So we're going to designate this upper strand of DNA as our template. Now we can create our replicated strand. And this strand is going to be called messenger RNA, and you'll see it abbreviated as mRNA. And you might also notice that I've used a nucleotide that's represented with a U as opposed to the one where there should be a T. Well, this nucleotide is known as uracil, and this is what we use instead of thymine when we're making messenger RNA. So this is the appropriate mRNA base complement for adenine. Now that we've copied our set of instructions from our DNA, we're now ready to perform what's known as translation, which is the process of making proteins. And this step is going to occur outside of the nucleus in one of these guys, which is known as ribosomal RNA, or simply a ribosome. So our DNA is going to be restored, and our messenger RNA has exited the nucleus and it's found a ribosomal RNA somewhere in the endoplasmic reticulum. Now, this ribosomal RNA is going to read this messenger RNA like a recipe, and it's going to make a protein from it. And it's going to read the nucleotides of the messenger RNA three at a time. And when these nucleotides are viewed three at a time, this is called a codon. And it's going to be the combination of codons that code for specific amino acids that will make up our proteins. So we see our messenger RNA has the codon of UUA, and this codes for an amino acid known as asparagine. So now the ribosomal RNA is going to call in another type of an RNA, a transfer RNA. And this guy, this transfer RNA, is going to have the amino acid the messenger RNA is calling for. And if we take a second look at this transfer RNA, we not only see that it has the asparagine sitting on top, but if we look at the bottom of it, we see that it also has nucleotides. But what these are the complementary base pairs to our codon. And on the transfer RNA, these nucleotides are known as an anticodon. So now that we've fulfilled the call for that first codon, the messenger RNA is moved along within the ribosomal RNA, and the ribosomal RNA is going to read the next codon, and then another transfer RNA bearing the next amino acid will get called in, and this time the amino acid is going to be valine. Our ribosomal RNA will connect our two amino acids. The transfer RNA that brought in asparagine will release asparagine, and then our messenger RNA will advance within the ribosomal RNA. The transfer RNA that brought in asparagine will be freed to go find another amino acid molecule of asparagine, and another amino acid will be called in based on the codon the ribosomal RNA is reading. Valine will be knitted to a new amino acid that was called in, proline, and valine's transfer RNA will release it. And that transfer RNA will be freed to find another amino acid molecule of valine, and the messenger RNA will advance once again within the ribosomal RNA, allowing the ribosomal RNA to read the next codon. Now, if we look on top, right here, we can see that we have a growing amino acid chain, and this someday will be our protein, which is, after all, the whole purpose of transcription and translation, making proteins. And that, my friends, is how you make a protein. Be sure to like up this video, click that subscription bar, and click on that notification bell. It really helps me out when you do that. And thanks for watching!